Now we got it. All right. Okay. Well, thank you for everyone who's joined tonight. My name is Jeff Robertson. I'm joined with Alistair Ling. And this is What's Up Over Edmonton for May of 2021. Got a picture of the Queen Elizabeth Planetarium because originally when we came up with this idea, we would hold these sessions live inside the QEP. But of course, COVID put paid on that. We were going to start last year, and with COVID, we decided we would do this online. So if you're wondering why there's a QAP here, that's the reason. The reason I call it What's Up Over Edmonton is because our skies are noticeably different than those in, say, southern Ontario. We have these star finders that we hand out at our observatory in Coronation Park. And I point out to people who ask that they're not entirely correct for Edmonton. And I like to use this example here. So this is the sky over Toronto on July the 5th at 11 o'clock. And we note the constellation Scorpio here. I always pick Scorpio because it sits fairly low in the sky, and according to the newspaper, I'm a Scorpio, even though I'm not. And I don't believe any of that anyway. So as you can see, Scorpio is fully above the horizon in Toronto. But in Edmonton, there's Scorpio here at 11 o'clock. Of course, 11 o'clock on July 5th, the sky is a lot lighter. But Scorpio never gets above the horizon completely. We only see the head and a little bit of the body. So that's one of the reasons I wanted to do this specifically for Edmonton skies, because like I say, our skies are different from where we are at 53 degrees north latitude. Most of the information I use comes out of the RASC Observer Handbook, and I also use Astronomy Magazine and Sky News. So some of the highlights in May, May flowers and endless twilight. We have the Eta Aquariid meteor shower, which peaks tonight or tomorrow morning, May the 6th. The best chance in 2021 to see Mercury in the evening sky. It's up right now after the sun goes down. And half an hour after the sun goes down, you can see it with binoculars, and as the sky gets a little bit darker, you can easily see it with the naked eye. Very early risers will see Jupiter and Saturn, and Venus is creeping into the evening sky after being in our morning sky for the last 9 months. We have perpetual twilight, which begins on May the 13th. Perpetual twilight simply means it never gets completely dark in Edmonton. And it's also a time to look for noctilucent clouds or NLCs. And we also have a total lunar eclipse on May the 26th. And I have an asterisk beside it because it happens early in the morning. And it's actually going on as the moon sets and the sun comes up. Now, normally I switch over to a Starry Night program, which is what you're seeing here in front of you, and I do it live. I do it live as I'm talking to you right now. But I decided to try things a little bit different because I do write myself a whole bunch of notes, and sometimes when I'm doing it live, I forget some stuff. So what I did, I recorded this a couple days ago. So we'll play it and hopefully it'll work out okay. So I'm just going to start it here. Or try to. Oh, no. Hang on here. Okay, we'll start the evening of tonight, May the 5th, at 9:45, the sun had set at 9:12, so it's just below the horizon. The sky is still fairly bright. We see Venus very low on the horizon. You'll need a fairly clear view of the western horizon to see it. It's only a couple degrees above the horizon. Mercury is a little higher, but dimmer. It's almost 10 degrees above the horizon. If we advance through the days, we can see Venus getting a little higher each day, as well as Mercury. And Mercury will continue to climb in the sky until the 17th, when it reaches its greatest distance from the Sun. Now, you'll notice that on the 12th, the Moon is parked right next to Venus. Venus should be pretty easy to see once the sky gets dark enough. It's fairly bright. It looks like an airplane landing light. Mercury, not so much. It needs to be a little bit darker, or maybe a pair of binoculars to see it. The next day, the 13th, the Moon is past Mercury. And we get to the 17th, and this is where Mercury is at its greatest eastern elongation. Okay, now I've advanced the time to 10 o'clock, which is about half an hour after the Sun set again, because the Sun was starting to interfere. And as we go day by day, we'll see Venus passing Mercury on the 28th of the month. And by the end of the month, Venus is well past Mercury. It's a little bit higher, and of course we see the Sun starting to peak above the horizon again at 10 o'clock, because by the end of the month, the Sun is set at 9:52. So the days are certainly getting longer. Now, you'll also note that Mars made a trip through Gemini. Let's just go back to the 5th again, and we can watch that. And I'll move that down a bit. And you can see, as Mars passes through the constellation Gemini, I should note that on the 15th, the Moon and Mars are fairly close together, about less than 2 degrees apart. Be a nice, nice view there. Oops, went the wrong way. And by the end of the month, Mars is pretty much done with Gemini. It's still within its constellation borders, but it's heading off to Cancer, the next constellation over. As I mentioned, on the 13th, we enter the period of perpetual twilight, which means the sky never gets completely dark in Edmonton. And there is always this twilight glow in the northern sky. So let's just have a quick look at the northern sky in May. If we look straight overhead, Ursa Major is almost, well, it is. It's directly overhead. It's right at the zenith. You really got to crane your neck to see it. There several good deep sky objects in Ursa Major, but I will wait until later on in the year when the constellation is a little bit lower in the sky to look at them, just because my scope is pointing straight up, my finder is pointing straight up, and it's kind of hard on the back to line everything up. So, okay, in the northern sky we see Lyra and Cygnus, which have been hanging around low in the north throughout the winter. They're with their bright star Vega and Deneb, which form part of the summer triangle. And let's just bring up that asterism. There we go. Altair is still below the horizon. The bright star Capella, which even though the sky in the north in Perpetual Twilight, you can still see it, and it's a good marker. It shows up in most of the pictures of noctilucent clouds, which I'll talk a little bit about today and a lot more next month. So if we go through the month, we see Capella swinging down low, and the summer triangle, which ironically is best visible in the autumn sky, starting to come up. And by the autumn time, the summer triangle will be almost directly overhead. Staying in the north, there are a few bright Messier objects, M13 in Hercules and M92. And if we swing over to the south, we have the Beehive, M44, great open cluster, easy to see in the, even in the city with binoculars. M36, 37, 38, also open clusters. M35, easy to see in a small telescope, and I'll be talking about that a little bit tonight. Shifting to the morning sky, and I've set the clock for 4 a.m. We have Jupiter just above the horizon, Saturn a little bit higher and to the west, and the Eta Aquarius peak actually tonight, early tomorrow morning. At 4 in the morning, this is where the radiant is, this is where the meteors appear to come from. They will go all over the sky. They can go this way, that way, all over the place. They don't follow any set directions. This is a better meteor shower to be seen in southern latitudes, particularly in the southern hemisphere. It's well placed, but for us in Edmonton, it's right along the horizon. And if I advance the clock a little bit, you see it really doesn't get all that high, and now the sun's up. So let's just reset to 4 a.m. There we go. Now by the end of the month, the sun is coming up just after 5 a.m. So let's just walk the two planets through the month here. Here comes the moon on the 26th. This is the night of the eclipse, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. And by the end of the month, on the last day of the month, the moon is placed between Jupiter and Saturn, just below it. Okay, about the eclipse of the moon, we will not see the entire eclipse because the moon will set before it is over. We might not even see totality, even though it's theoretically possible, because the sun is coming up and it's getting bright, and the moon, of course, is going to be a lot dimmer than normal. So we may not even see the moon in totality. What are they calling it? A red, blood red flower supermoon or something? Anyway. So let's zoom in here, and we're going to advance the clock. So at 2:47, the moon enters the Earth's preumbra, its outer shadow, and it starts to get a little bit dusky. By 3:44, it starts to enter the umbra, the darkest part of the shadow. And there you see it there. And let's just pull back to get a little bit of perspective here. Totality begins at 5:11, and I'm going to adjust my timing here to advance it 10 seconds at a time so it's not moving so quickly. As you can see, the sky is getting quite a bit lighter, and totality begins at 5:11. I missed it by seconds here. Let's go back up here. Okay, 5:11, totality. The moon is right above the Earth's shadow, or right above the Earth's, right above the horizon. But if we go look over here, the sun is starting to come up. The sun comes up at 5:17. So as a full moon is does it, the full moon sets just as the sun comes up. So totality, like I say, totality begins at 5:11. It's a very short eclipse. It's the moon is passing through the top part of the Earth's shadow, and here we watch it set. And at 5:25, it's over. It starts to move out of the shadow, but by that time the moon is already below the horizon. And as we pan over here, the sun is already up. So we'll see. We have a little bit more to say about that later on. And finally, don't forget about satellites. We're entering prime satellite season here in Edmonton, with the sun just below the horizon. It illuminates all sorts of stuff flying over us, the brightest one being the ISS. This is a pass on May the 9th at just after 3 in the morning, and it's running at twice normal speed, so you can see it there. The ISS is inclined at a 51.5 degree orbit. We're at 53, so the ISS is always in the south, never in the north. And there goes and all those other little dots you see flying around or other satellites. Okay. Okay, before I start this, are there any questions? Or, and Alistair, do you have anything to add?
Thank you. No.
No? Okay. Any questions? Okay. All right. Let's. Okay. And.
What do you see when you look at the moon when it's full and round? Do you see a balloon? Does it look like a cookie with the bite taken out? What do you see when you look at the moon?
It follows. Okay. The moon phases for May. The third quarter was the third, a couple days ago, or last quarter. The moon is new on the 11th, and also marks the end of Ramadan. First quarter is on the 19th of the month, and the moon is full on the 26th. We have the eclipse. The May full moon is also known as the flower moon, also the corn planting moon, for obvious reasons, and the milk moon for reasons I don't know. Okay, now this is a page out of the Explore the Moon certificate download from the RASC. It's a program you can participate in, and when you complete the program, you send it in, and they will send you a certificate and a pin. And I take features from the Explore the Moon program and go a little bit in depth. And this is from the Explore the Moon with binoculars. They also have a telescope version as well. And there's also a very advanced version if you're interested in pursuing that as well. So the feature I chose today is Clavius, which is the second largest crater on the moon. And so this is one of my poor pictures of the moon. And Clavius is right there. It's down in the southern portion of the moon. And it's just below the crater Tycho, which when the moon is full is extremely obvious because it has a massive ray pattern You can see bits of it on this side of the moon. But when the moon is full, Tycho is the most obvious thing on the surface. It's an easy target in binoculars, and it's best seen on day 9, day 10. And it's in the Southern Highlands. It's 231 kilometers across, and it's about 3,500 meters deep. I have some close-ups here. This is a view from Earth by someone who could take much better photographs than I can. And as you can see, it's a very old crater, and you can tell it's a very old crater because it has lots of craters within within it, and also along its wall, which is well eroded. And this is a view looking top down from the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. So you can see a lot more craters. They estimate it's almost 4 billion years old, which is so it was probably formed in the period of the early bombardment after the moon was formed. Clavius is also noted in the movie 2001 A Space Odyssey for the American moon base, which they set up there in that very fine movie. Also of note, findings from the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter indicates that there could be traces of water underneath the surface. So maybe that's why the Americans chose to build the base there for the movie. Just kidding. They didn't know about the water back then. Our constellation for this month is Gemini, the twins. So here is the constellation there with the twin stars Pollux and Castor. And there is a representation of the twins, two brothers. Now, in Greek mythology, Castor and Pollux were half-brothers, the sons of Leda, wife of the king of Sparta. Leda was seduced by the very randy king of the god Zeus and bore Pollux, who ended up being immortal because he was the son of a god. Castor was the king's offspring, but even though they had different fathers, the brothers were extremely close. And when Castor died, Pollux begged his father Zeus to make his brother immortal. So Zeus placed both brothers in the sky. Now, Greek mythology isn't the only story about this constellation. I found one from the Blackfoot people who live in the southern part of Alberta. And its story is, there was a man named Smart Crow who was married and had two sons. One day when Smart Crow was out hunting, a stranger came to the lodge and killed the wife. Doesn't really say why. Then the stranger saw the two infants and named them Ashes Chief and Struck Behind. Smart Crow returned from hunting and was very sad and angry when he found his dead wife. And the stranger convinced Smart Crow that his wife would live again if Smart Crow gave his sons to a rock and a beaver. The boys grew up wild until Smart Crow brought them home again. One day the boys wandered to where their mother lay. They took meat from all parts of a buffalo, and to help their mother live, she rose and took a breath. The boys had power when they grew into men. At the end of their lives, Ashes Chief took his white robe and eagle feather and rose to the sky. Struck Behind was carried to the sky on the branches of a tree, and the two became the twin stars. So that's two stories about Gemini. As I said, the two brightest stars in the constellation are Pollux and Castor. Both can be easily seen in the city. And there they are together, different colors. Interesting note, when our observatory was open in Coronation Park in the daytime, I could easily see both those stars in the daytime through our 16-inch telescope. So this is a close-up of Castor, and it is a twin star. And as I just mentioned, I could see Castor in the daytime in our 16-inch scope, and I could actually see the two stars in the scope in the daytime. At night, of course, it's very easy to see. Castor actually is not a double star system. It's actually six stars in one system, but this picture, you can't split the other stars. And it's about 51 light years away. Pollux is a red giant star. It's 34 light years away. It's the brighter of the two stars in the constellation. And this picture shows Pollux here with our own sun as comparison. So as you can see, Pollux is a red giant star, most likely near the end of its life. There is one open cluster in Gemini, and it is M35 or Messier 35. It's an open cluster consisting of about 400 stars. It's a fairly large cluster in the sky. It's about half degree across, which is about the size of the full moon. It's about 3,800 light years away, and it can be seen in binoculars or, of course, a small telescope. And it is at the foot of Castor. There's also another open cluster, NGC 2158, not very far away, which begs the question, I wonder, maybe I should go into a little bit of detail about Messier objects. Messier objects are named after a French astronomer, Charles Messier, who was a comet hunter. And what he did, he logged all the fuzzy objects he saw in the sky so they would not be mistaken as comets. So it kind of makes me wonder how he missed NGC 2158 when it was so close to M35. I guess we'll never know. I guess he didn't see that guy. Other highlights this month are the Eta Aquarius, which I mentioned earlier, happening tonight, tomorrow morning. About 50 meteors an hour under the best of circumstances. But like I say, it's fairly low in the sky. Mercury is at its greatest eastern elongation on May the 17th. Venus is still low on twilight, but Mercury is easily seen now. You don't have to wait till the 17th to go look for it. Go look for it now after the sun goes down. It looks pretty clear out still, so maybe worth a trip outside to a good clear view of the western horizon to have a look at the brighter Venus and Mercury. Take a pair of binoculars with you if you got them. Noctilucent cloud season begins after mid-month when we enter the period of perpetual twilight. And I'll have a little bit more to say about that in a minute. It's also my favorite feature on the moon, the Lunar X, which will be visible for a few hours around 5:40 p.m. on May the 18th. That's a Tuesday. And the total lunar eclipse on the morning of the 26th. And I put a little note, totality may be impossible to see for the reasons I gave earlier. So the Eta Aquarius, as I mentioned, this is the radiant. They're very fast meteors. They travel about 55 kilometers per second. As I said, about 50 an hour at its peak. They originate from the Earth passing through the cloud of debris left by Comet Halley. There is another meteor shower that comes from the Earth passing through the debris of Comet Halley called the Orionids in about 6 months when we're on the other side of our orbit. Dawn comes soon after the radiant rises, and like I say, it's better seen further south, maybe someplace like Chile. Now, Venus is in the sky again. And a little explanation about how Venus travels. It does not travel the same route in the sky every time it's in the evening sky. It actually, there are five paths the planet follows in the evening sky, and five paths in the morning sky. And this pattern repeats every 5 years. If you'll remember last year, Venus was riding very high in the sky from late winter all the way up to spring. This was the path it followed until April, May was still, and then it dropped very rapidly to the horizon. And then it would go into the morning sky and repeat this pattern, only backwards. It would rise very high, stay very high for a while, and then sink down toward the horizon again. So the next one up is this pattern, and it starts here. Now, ignore, well, just a bit of better, whoops. This is a close view. Ignore the dates. I took this from an older book, but the, like I say, it's a repeating pattern. So the months are fairly close. They don't change much. So just ignore the 2005. So Venus starts here, rises up a little bit, and then it is in this period right now where it's rising up above the horizon. Then it's going to skirt the horizon for pretty much all through the summer until the middle of autumn, and then it'll start to rise up. It'll reach its highest point end of November, early December, and then scoot down to the horizon, and then it will go into the morning sky, and it'll repeat this pattern again, only backwards, rising fairly high up and then going down and then riding the horizon and down again. In a telescope, depending whether you're looking in the morning sky or the evening sky, in the evening sky, Venus starts off fairly small, almost a full disk, because it's, from our point of view, it's on the other side of the sun in its orbit, and gets larger and larger, a little bit thinner, 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 until it starts to come into where it crosses between the Earth and the sun. We call it we get a nice crescent, and the planet gets larger and larger. So even though the planet is not illuminated on its full extent like down here, it reaches its brightest point in our sky when it's in this phase here, when it's a crescent, because it's so much bigger and so much closer to the Earth.
Heavenly shades of night are falling, it's twilight time. Out of the mist your voice is calling, 'tis twilight time. When purple colored curtains mark the end of day, I'll hear you, my dear.
Okay, as I mentioned, we're entering the period of perpetual twilight here. These are the three stages of twilight. We have civil twilight, when the sun is 6 degrees below the horizon. Nautical twilight is when the sun is between 6 and 12% below the horizon, or 12 degrees, I should say. And astronomical twilight, when the sun is 12 to 18 degrees below the horizon. And then below that, the sky goes completely dark, and we consider that night. We are in this astronomical twilight time between May 13th and July 31st. So the sun will never get, or pardon me, the sky will never get completely dark in that period of time. Now, one of the benefits here in Edmonton is we get to see something called noctilucent clouds, or night shining clouds. And these are clouds made up of particles 80 kilometers up in the sky, with the sun below the horizon shining on them. and they're only visible in northern latitudes. On occasion, places further south, like down 45, 42 degrees, may see them, but they're very rare when that occurs. But here in Edmonton, we see them all the time. Now, this is a view I took from the street in front of my house, and I live in a, you might recognize this building here as the Misericordia Hospital, so you know that the West Edmonton Mall is right about here, and within 2 kilometers is about a half a dozen, well, probably closer to a dozen car dealerships. So the skies in my neighborhood are fairly well light polluted, but still you can see these noctilucent clouds, and they're a beautiful electric blue color. And next one here, I have a little video that one of our members took and uploaded it onto our YouTube site. And this just repeats. Now, I will point out, if you look up here, you'll see Capella come into view. There it is there, the Bright Star Capella. So yeah, these things do move. Not as fast as this video, because this is a time-lapse video, and I actually sped up the original video that I took off YouTube. But they're really beautiful. We have one member who goes out looking for them every clear night during this period. And I don't know what his record is, but he's seen dozens and dozens and dozens of MLCs in a single year. And as I mentioned, the Lunar X, which is going to be visible late afternoon on the 18th, so it will be daylight. And there it is there. I've seen it in the daylight. It's really easy to see. I might even try and get a picture of it on the 18th if the skies are clear. There's also a Lunar V. Look for that too. It's in the same general area. And what the Lunar X is it's sunlight shining on the tops of crater walls around the crater Warner. And it only lasts about 4 hours, because as the sun rises up, the X disappears. Now, Alistair Ling sent me 2 slides about the lunar eclipse. He was going to use them in his introduction to stargazing session, which will be on the 26th, but of course the eclipse will be over by now. So I've asked Alistair if he could just explain what we're seeing here.
Okay. It's going to be, well, as I call it, a disappointing event for the general public, who are all hyped up to see a deep red blood-curdling supermoon. But it's always of interest to any keen sky watcher, because we will see the partial phases for sure. The problem is that the sky starts to get lighter and lighter as we head into totality. So the picture in the corner here shows a totally eclipsed moon low in the sky. And you can see the light has just started up. It's that sort of steel blue lighting. But in this case, the sky is going to be even lighter than this. And so if you head to the next image, please, Jeff. The problem is essentially, it's a double problem. One is that the moon goes from being very bright, as you see in this upper left corner, down and then straight below it, is a totally eclipsed moon, so it gets very faint compared to its normal situation. In the middle upper segment is the moon setting, just a normal full moon. It's deliberately overexposed here to show constant exposure. So both frames in the just center left, the upper and lower are at the same exposure, but as the moon gets closer and closer to the horizon, it's going through more and more atmosphere, and so it gets dimmer. And just as the sun does, as you know, blazingly bright when it's high up, and sometimes if there's enough dust in the air, it'll or smoke, it dims enough that you can see the disk without it blowing out your vision. So those two things combined will give something like just right of center. So you'll get so here's a normal moon just taken a couple of weeks ago. At 6 minutes before sunrise. So the sky is quite light, and a normal full moon is, although it's overexposed here, this is how light the sky is going to be. And I sifted through all of my images to find one taken with the same exposure as I did with the normally full moon, and it comes out this bright against a dark sky, completely at right. But if you put that same exposure with a much brighter sky that we'll get 6 minutes before, it's going to be nearly invisible. Maybe the upper edge, in our case, it'll be over to the other side a bit. The upper edge that is closest to not being eclipsed will probably just get to see it. So my bet is just as it enters totality, it's going to disappear unless the sky is really, really, really clean. I think you'll certainly need binoculars, and you might just see the ghost of a limb left over. No blood, just the screams of sky watchers going, "Oh no, it's gone." So that's where we're at with this one. But I think the partial phases are always interesting to see, and who can hate a spring morning with the birds chirping as the sky gets lighter? It's a wonderful time of the year anyway. So get out there and have a look anyways.
Okay, thanks, Alistair. And yes, you can watch the round shadow of the Earth cross the moon. Because, of course, we are living on a big ball. Okay, I'll go to the space history section. I've jazzed up my opening graphic a bit. I added a bit of music to it. I thought it needed some. Okay. I always pick something or one or two items that happened in the month, in this case, the month of May, in a year that is, or an anniversary year that is divisible by five. So a year that ends in a six or a one. So we're going to go back. I have two today. I have one, May 10th, 1946. Oh my gosh, it's a V2 rocket. And on the 10th of May, the first successful flight of a captured V2 in the United States occurred. Of course, the V2 was one of Germany's wonder weapons in the Second World War. At the end of the war, a number of German scientists and engineers led by Wernher von Braun escaped and surrendered to the Americans, and they also brought with them a number of pieces of hardware, including several of the V2 missiles and the launch equipment, et cetera, et cetera. You can see a few pieces of the German equipment, like the Erector is German, this liquid oxygen tank and transport, that's German. they worked with the American Army to improve the V2. Of course, von Braun, say what you will about the man and his association with the Nazis, he always was interested in space travel. And he worked with the Americans to develop the Jupiter and the Saturn rockets, which eventually put men on the moon. The direct descendant of the V2 would probably be the Redstone rocket, which we'll talk about in just a minute. So this is a launch of the V2. In the nose, it carried scientific equipment. This was the third attempt to launch a rocket. The first two failed. But this one actually succeeded and went to a height of 112 kilometers. And of course, what goes up must come down. So even without a one-ton worth of explosives in its nose cone, this is a crater it made when it came back to Earth. So it was going at a pretty good lick when it hit the ground. Sorry, I'm just flipping my notes here. And the next event, May 5th, 1961, so 60 years ago today. And this was the flight of Freedom 7, Alan Shepard, the first American in space, riding in a Mercury capsule. This is a drawing of the Mercury capsule. It was extremely small, only a little more than 6 feet across. The whole thing was 26 feet long, but most of that was the launch escape tower. This is Alan Shepard in his Mercury suit. There were seven Mercury astronauts picked in 1958. They called themselves the Mercury Seven. In addition to Al Shepard, there was Gus Grissom, John Young, Deke Slayton, Scott Carpenter, Wally Schirra, and Gordon Cooper. Six of them made flights in the Mercury capsule. Deke Slayton did not because they picked up a heart murmur, and he was scrubbed from flight duty. He didn't actually get into space until 1975 with the very last Apollo mission. The Apollo Soyuz mission in 1975 was his first and only space flight. But all the Mercury astronauts did eventually make it into space. Mercury capsule, as I said, was very small. Sometimes people said you didn't exactly get into it as put it on. Very cramped. I'm a fairly big fella. I would not fit in this thing. In fact, I wouldn't even be considered for an astronaut job because you couldn't be more than 6 feet. Otherwise, you wouldn't fit. So Shepard was launched on the 5th of May. He soared in a suborbital flight. He went up 187 kilometers high and went 487 kilometers downrange. He had about 6 minutes of zero G, in which time he was able to control the craft and pitch, roll, and yaw. Mercury could not change its orbit. It could only change its attitude. So it could pitch up and down, it could roll, and it could yaw back and forth. He made some brief observations of the Earth, and then he fired the retro rockets, even though if he didn't fire the retro rockets, he would still come down because he was in a suborbital trajectory. The Redstone didn't have enough thrust to put the capsule into orbit. But he fired the retro rockets to test the system, which would be needed on orbital missions to get down. And if anyone's ever played Kerbal Space Program, you know that if you ever fly a ballistic trajectory, you pull a lot of Gs coming back through the atmosphere. And Shepard pulled 11 Gs coming back through the atmosphere. And if you listen to the transcripts or the tapes of the flight, when he's in this high G area, the only thing he can get out is, okay, Okay. That's all he could get out. So there's the Freedom 7 spacecraft lifting off. It's also known as Mercury Redstone 3. They flew the Redstone twice before putting a person inside of it. MR1 was unmanned, MR2 had a chimpanzee named Ham, and then MR3 was Shepard's Flight. Now, because a lot of people watch movies. There's two Hollywood movies that I think about when I think about Alan Shepard's Flight. And the first one is The Right Stuff. And yes, Shepard did have to urinate in his spacesuit because it was only going to be a 15, 20 minute flight. And they didn't really think about having to go to the bathroom. But he sat on the pad for 3 hours worth of delays, and well, the man had to go. So that is true. They shut off, you know, they were worried about a short in the system in the suit because of all the medical sensors attached to him. And Shepard just said, well, just turn them off. And I got to go. So they turned them off. And the pure oxygen in the flowing through the suit dried up the urine, and they turned everything back on. Everything was fine. And then in the movie Hidden Figures, there's a scene that made my eyebrows kind of go up where one of the characters bursts into a meeting and says, the Redstone doesn't have enough thrust to go into orbit. And they're all kind of, well, they knew that from the get-go. I mean, that wasn't news. The Atlas was always going to be the rocket to put a craft in orbit. It is the one that had enough thrust. The Redstone was always only meant for a suborbital flight. Becoming the first American in space was, he became the second man in space. Of course, there was a race to beat the Russians into space, but Gagarin beat him in April, and he actually orbited the Earth. And this was a suborbital flight, which, you know, isn't as great as an orbital flight, but still, it gave the Americans a lot of confidence in their system. So I've got a video of the launch here.
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, ignition.
Liftoff. All right, liftoff, and the clock is starting. Yes, sir, we can allow it clear. I tell you. This is Freedom 7. The fuel is go 1.237 at 14 PSI. Oxygen is go.
Okay,
it's a lot smoother now, a lot smoother.
Roger.
Following the flight, Shepard was a hero. He was given ticker tape parades and presented with a medal at the White House. Also, you'll notice in the corner there was a picture, a movie camera was pointed at Shepard for the whole flight. There was also another camera behind him pointed at the instrument panel that they would look at and examine when he came back, just to see what the instruments were saying. Now, the next video is from the 25th of May, just later on that month, 20 days later. So the United States, with 15 minutes of experience in space travel, committed to going to the moon. Now, it does have that little bit, you know, I believe this nation should commit herself, blah, blah, blah. But I've also included a preamble before he got to that part, which he kind of explains the political reasons for going. It wasn't about science. It was about showing the world that the West, which would be the United States, NATO, Australia, was better than the Soviet bloc, the Warsaw Pact, China, et cetera, et cetera. So we'll go with this speech.
Finally, if we are to win the battle that is now going on around the world between freedom and tyranny, the dramatic achievements in space which occurred in recent weeks should have made clear to us all, as did the Sputnik in 1957, the impact of this adventure on the minds of men everywhere who are attempting to make a determination of which road they should take. Since early in my term, our efforts in space have been under review. With the advice of the Vice President, who is chairman of the National Space Council, we have examined where we are strong and where we are not, where we may succeed and where we may not. Now it is time to take longer strides, time for a great new American enterprise, time for this nation to take a clearly leading role in space achievement, which in many ways may hold the key to our future on Earth. I believe we possess all the resources and talents necessary, but the facts of the matter are that we have never made the national decisions or marshaled the national resources required for such leadership. We have never specified long-range goals on an urgent time schedule or managed our resources and our time so as to ensure their fulfillment. I therefore ask the Congress, above and beyond the increases I have earlier requested for space activities, to provide the funds which are needed to meet the following national goals. First, I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth. No single space project in this period will be more impressive to mankind or more important for the long-range exploration of space, and none will be so difficult or expensive to accomplish.
Okay. Yeah, and I could go on and on about the political reasons for Apollo, but you know, it was basically Cold War reasoning that Heavens Above is a website I always reference because it has all sorts of information of what's up in the sky, satellites, comets, whatever. It's a great resource. The next What's Up is on June 2nd at 7:30. Also, I'll remind you that our next general meeting of the Edmonton Center, the RESC, is May the 10th. And Alistair will be doing his introduction to stargazing on May the 26th. All these occur at 7:30 Mountain Daylight Time. And with that, I will say thank you. And are there any questions?
Well, while people are thinking of their questions, I'll chip in something. I love the space history stuff, mostly because I've only had a fleeting connection with it. I was on the slightly younger side, but I remember in watching The Right Stuff, and they showed real footage of rockets blowing up on the launch pad. I mean, partly from a film perspective to add to the drama, but I mean, the drama was quite real. I had seen Hollywood things blowing up. And when you see a real thing blow up with that kind of violence, there's all sorts of micro fine detail that is just not there in the Hollywood stuff. And so it's just like, oh, that's real. And I could just feel it sinking in when they showed launch after launch failure, just like, ugh. And there's one beautiful one where you see the thing sort of taking off. I think it's slowing down. And then pause, uh-oh. and then, of course, when it hits the launch pad, sinks back on the launch pad, just absolute Well, that just must have been amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing,
yeah,
too.
They blew up a lot of rockets back then. Well, the Americans' first attempt at launching a satellite exploded on the launch pad, too. So Vanguard 1, they called it Kaputnik.
Jeff, I have a question. You didn't mention the Chinese rocket first stage that's going to come crashing down to the Earth. They're saying probably the 9th, but
yeah,
they're not sure.
Yeah, it's the core stage of the rocket. They just launched the first the core stage of their proposed space station. So this is a fair hunk of hardware. This is the second time. This is the Long March 5 that they're using. This is the second time they've launched a Long March 5. And the same thing happened with the stage, with that rocket. The core stage eventually came back and landed somewhere in the Ivory Coast. Now, most space agencies, you know, try and target these, you know, big hunks of hardware to land in the ocean somewhere. The Chinese don't seem to be worried about that, thinking, well, the Earth's mostly water, it'll probably land in the ocean, I guess. I don't know. We're in no danger where we are, but because the orbital inclination is 41 degrees. It's a fair hunk of Africa, South America, Central America, lower part of the United States. You know, so yeah, it could come down over populated areas for sure. And I don't know why they don't make allowances for deorbiting the thing so it comes down in the ocean somewhere.
In the States, would we be able to see it from up here, do you think?
Probably not, because it'll be fairly low in the atmosphere by the time it starts to burn up. Because it'll break up. It'll break up. Mm-hmm. It won't be one big hunk of material coming down. It'll fragment. It'll be, you know, like a cluster bomb, really. I think we'll be able to see the station once it'll be really low in the south, because, like I say, it's inclined at 41 degrees, where the ISS is 51. So I think we can see the station from here on occasion if it happens to reach, you know, the top of its path while it's below Edmonton, but I don't think we'll see it enter the atmosphere. No, it'll be just too low. It'll be, you know, when it starts to hit the heavy atmosphere, it's only going to be about, 60 to 80 miles above the Earth. So it'll be too low to see it.
Okay.
It will be spectacular if it comes by and comes down at night.
Yeah, I remember. Yeah,
41 degrees, I don't think we'll be able to see it, will we?
No.
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
Very close to being right on the horizon.
Yeah. Their first space station, you could see it occasionally. It was at 42 degrees, and you could sometimes see it. I never saw it. Anytime I, saw, you can go out and see it, it was always cloudy. So, but I'll just watch Heavens Above, and if there's an opportunity to see it, I'll give it a go. Yeah,
because, for example, the Hubble Space Telescope, we cannot see it from here.
No, it's 30. Too low it's 30.
30, 35 degrees or something, isn't it?
Yeah. Any other questions, comments, insults, hate mail, anything? Tomatoes?
Jeff, I have just one question. In your talk on Clavius on the moon,
yes.
You mentioned that it had a depth of 3,500 meters.
Yeah.
And that's 3.5 kilometers deep.
Yep.
Is that struck me as pretty darn deep. Is that from the top of the crater wall down to the...
That's from the top of the highest part of the rim that survives to the floor.
Okay.
So the real crater would have been even deeper because the central peak and stuff is just buried under.
Yeah, yeah. It's a very, very old crater. Very old crater.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. That's a, it'd be a good hike.
But okay. But probably pretty gentle, because even the straight wall feature that we get to see, while it looks like a cliff, apparently they said it would be pretty tough to toboggan down, because it's only about 7 degrees or something like that.
Yeah, the shadows make it look a lot worse than what it actually is. So. But a lot of the moon is like that. You know, it's not the big jagged peaks that we imagined. It's they're fairly smooth. I read somewhere that on Olympus Mons on Mars, you could be walking up it and not even realize you're walking up on an incline because it's just so big, and the slope is so gentle.
Yeah, the summit is over the horizon.
Yeah.
Okay, no, that's cool.
All right. Well, if there's nothing else, I will say thank you to everyone who joined us tonight. And hopefully we can see you again in June. And
remember to have a look at Mercury tonight.
Yeah, look at Mercury. Yeah, it's still clear out. So,
yeah. 10 past 10.
Okay, good night. Okay, good night. Yep, good night.